Welcome to another episode of The Heart of the Matter. For most crimes, it's victims that matters. Their pain is everyone's pain. However, for rape victims, it is totally different. Oftentimes, they feel all alone, they're ashamed, and they're often labeled as rape victims. Today, we're speaking up against sexual violence, and we have with us the founder of AID Foundation, Ezinne Akudo, who is also currently Miss Nigeria. Ezinne, thank you very much for coming to The Heart of the Matter.
Thank you for having me.
It's a pleasure. Why sexual violence?
Two things. The first is because of my friend. When I was in university, I have a very close friend of mine. She was raped when we were in school. And it was a very horrible situation because then we had exams to write the following day. And she was going to class to read at night, and it was raining. So she told us she was coming back, so she left, and she came back like just a few hours after, and she was crying, her clothes were torn. We couldn't tell anybody, no one knew what to do, even the hospitals around didn't even have, you know, such facilities to accommodate what had happened to her. And it was just a very horrible time. I don't even want to remember what happened. So I decided to create a platform that, you know, victims, I call them survivors. I decided to create a platform that survivors can reach out to for help, be it legal help, medical assistance, rehabilitation, counseling, as the case may be.
Okay, so that's the AID Foundation.
Yeah, that's what the AID Foundation does.
Why the name AID actually?
AID signifies new beginning. The figure AID signifies new beginning. So I wanted to use that name because, I mean, if it's new beginning, foundation, then it's somewhere you can come to and leave feeling better and different.
Okay. So how has the silence culture in our country helped to promote crimes like rape?
You know, and also that's one of the issues that we are facing, even though so many people are actually speaking up about it, but you find out that most of, especially parents, most of them don't want to speak out. They prefer to label it a family matter or sweep it under the carpet and, you know, let it just end like that. And I mean, if no one knows what's going on, then the victim or the survivor can get help. The police can get involved. Lawyers can get involved. Even the counselor can't even get involved. So you sweep it under the carpet and then you're left, the survivor is left feeling totally bad for most of her lifetime. So I think it has actually encouraged this particular crime, because then if people speak up about it, then people know, okay, this is what's going on, and they can also get help.
Yeah, and I think also the perpetrators, they know that most victims of rape would not talk. And so they know, they think they can get away with this, and that's why they keep doing it over and over again. Can you tell us some of the case studies or stories that the AID Foundation has attended to?
Well, I'll just say most of our cases are father-daughter. So we have, yes, majority of our cases are actually girls that are under, let's say, the age of 15. Wow. So we've had 7 years, we've had 10 months, we've had...
10 months?
Yes, we've had 10 months.
And how did they find out?
Well, you know, it's complicated because the mother was even aware of it. And she said it's been happening since the baby was 8. So everything blew up after she had issues with him, and, you know, she now reached out to us. And, you know, I can't really give you details of the whole, you know, because most of our...
Wow.
Yeah.
And so what kind of support do you provide in that?
Well, it depends. It depends on the particular individual. Sometimes they come to us when it's just happened, and what we do is refer them to one of our partners, Mirabel Center, where they go to for medical checkup, forensics, and, you know, also to do like tests and also get medication to stop diseases that can come up from there. So if it's something that just happened, then that's the first thing we recommend. Then after that, depending on what the survivor feels, you know, then we can also refer counseling. But in some cases where, or in most cases where, it, you know, the perpetrator is the survivor's father, then you can't say, okay, let me counsel her, and then you send her back to the house where everything is happening, because that's going to defeat the entire purpose. So depending on the case, we also have partners that have shelters. So sometimes we have to take her out of there for the meantime. And then sometimes the father threatens, we're not going to pay school fees, blah, blah, blah. So we also take care of that as well. I mean, you know, so.
So, but what about prosecuting? Do you get to prosecute the...
Sometimes. You know, it's very complicated and, you know, it gets a bit annoying sometimes. So we don't recommend going to court or charging as soon as they come. It's only if the survivor insists or family members insist that this case must go up, then we refer them also to our legal partners as well, which is the Office of Public Defender here in Lagos.
So
they take care of that if the victim or survivor wants to, but we don't, you know, we don't push her to do, because sometimes when the case even starts, you find out that you maybe after like 2-3 sessions of court, they say they're no longer interested, they want to settle out, and then resources have gone in, you different things. So we only go that far when we are sure that it's something that the survivor wants.
Would you, aside from those reasons, do you think it's best if, because I think in developed other economies, like in the US, they usually would prosecute the perpetrator. Do you think, would you encourage people to do that? And could it also be because of the stigma involved, because they would have to obviously testify, and a lot of families like to just keep things under?
Yeah, I'm a lawyer too. So I'm a fan of prosecuting. I believe that rape as a crime shouldn't go unpunished, because this is something that you do to someone and then she has the rest of her life thinking about it. So I actually like for them to be prosecuted, but it has to be the choice or decision of the survivor herself.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. Interesting. So in terms of how do you get them back into society? How do you build confidence? Because a lot of rape victims feel that, one, they feel that they're the cause of it. A lot of people tell them, say things like, oh, it's because of what you're wearing or what you were wearing, or you are flirting, or you know. How do you bring self-confidence?
Like we said, we offer counseling and rehabilitation. But again, it depends on each individual. We also have various partners that have programs for rehabilitation. We have skills acquisition. Depending on the interest, we won't force you to learn a trade that you're not interested in. So after they meet the counselor, we know exactly what she needs. Does she need to move to a new place? Does she need to go back to school? Does she need to start up a small business? So we also have partners too that fund, you know, small businesses like that. So depending on, you know, what the survivor needs, then we know exactly what program to feed her into.
We need to take a quick break and we'll continue after the break. Viewers, stay tuned, we'll be right back after the break. The heart of the matter. We still have with us Ezinne Akudo, founder of the AID Foundation and Miss Nigeria. Ezinne, could you please tell us one of your stories and the transformation process?
Okay, I will give you the story of the 10-month-old person or baby that we had. The mother said it's been happening since the child was 8, and then she just thought, she was aware, and you know, everybody kept quiet about it, swept under the carpet for 2 months. So this actually came up because I think the man beat her up. So it was actually a domestic violence case, and because of that, she spoke up about what the father also does to, you know, his child. And then the police took the case up. The case is in court right now as we speak. But she couldn't go back home, because then the guy was released on bail. and his family members threatened her. He threatened her. She had two other children, so she couldn't go back. And yes, and one of our partners, which is Pastor Bimbo Dukoya Foundation, they have a shelter for traumatized women. So that's where she is currently, and she's, you know, receiving, you know, welfare assistance from them.
So I find that a lot of people also would be afraid that if they speak up, especially women,
yes,
or wives, if they speak up, but
and that's the end.
That's the end. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes, the husband is the breadwinner, so they lose their home, they lose their family.
They lose
what you're saying is that you have a support system, a shelter to help them. What is the process? So imagine someone that's watching the episode now and has been raped. What should they expect when they come to your foundation?
Okay, we have a toll-free line. That means if you call us, you know, you don't have to pay credit or whatever, which is 0800D8, which is THE and 8. You can call us 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. every day, Monday to Friday, and or visit our office, that's where the center is, the Rape Crisis Center, which is in Lekki Zone, or you check our website, theaidfoundation.org. Our details are also there, and descriptions on how to get to the place. So when you eventually come to the place, like I said, it depends on each case. If it's something that just happened, then we refer you for medical assistance first. Then eventually you come back and the counselor talks to you and knows exactly what you need. And then based on her recommendations, we know, okay, are we going to just try to get her to a place where she's safe? Are we trying to, you know, get the police involved or get other partners involved as well?
Okay. Yeah. And then from that, then there's
and
also...
then from that, they take it up. So our different partners have different things. We have Office of the Public Defender. They handle all legal cases free of charge. We also have Nigerian Bar Association as one of our partners too.
Okay.
Yes, and then we have the Mirabel Center, which does exactly what we do, but they're located in a hospital, so it's easier for them to, you know, access medical facilities and all that. And everybody is just, you know, involved in different things, so we don't really do everything. So depending on exactly what you need, and then we know who to send you to, and then we take it up from there and we follow up on each person.
And it wouldn't cost the victim?
No, everything is free.
Everything is free.
Okay. Oh, I forgot to mention, we also have Easy Taxi as one of our partners as well. So if you call us and tell us where you are, we'll send a taxi to pick you and you don't have to pay anything.
Oh, wow. Because
awesome. We know we're located in Lekki and most people complain it's far from wherever. Yeah. For all you have to do is tell us where you are and we send the Easy Taxi exactly to where you are.
So is there anything for viewers that are watching, young women who have not thankfully been raped, is there anything they can do to prevent yes?
Well, you know, there are a few tips when people, you know, there are a few tips they told us about when we were in university. Don't walk alone in a lonely place, but you know, sometimes even after you observe all precautions, it still happens. And
yes,
you can imagine if it's your father, then you can't actually protect yourself, because this is someone that is supposed to protect you. How can you, you know, trust somebody else? So that's a very tough one.
Yes,
that's really a very tough one. But I'm just going to say, if you notice the signs, because sometimes it doesn't just happen at once.
Exactly.
They
how
give
do you,
you
know?
Exactly. So if you notice the signs and you're not comfortable, especially if you're a very young girl, if you notice the signs, you have to tell your mother about it. Because I always tell my aunties, what's wrong with telling your daughter, you know, that this isn't right? They'll say, no, maybe when she's up to 4, when she's 5. But I said, we've had cases of even younger than four. What's wrong with telling her the right names of all the parts that she has, or the right names of her body organs? What's wrong with telling them, see, if daddy touches you anyway that you don't understand, you tell me.
Mm-hmm.
What's wrong with telling them your teacher can't touch you? Everybody's just so very, you know, somewhat about the topic. And sometimes it's annoying, because then when you hear cases and then you're like, so what did your mother do about it? They said, she doesn't even know, because I can't even tell her. So I think for mothers, it's about creating that awareness in, you know, in the heads of their young daughters, no matter the age. I don't think there is any age suitable for it now, because it happens to anybody. anybody.
So do you also go to schools? Do you provide...
Yes, we go to schools to sensitize. So we let them know this happens and it's okay, but this is what you can do if you notice something. Because most of the cases are also teacher and student.
Wow.
Yes. So we also, you know, create that awareness, let them know. We also have programs for marketplaces and then slums as well. So you also let them know there's a place you can reach out to in case you need help or in case you're experiencing the same thing.
So why, before we round up, why is it important to speak up? What does that do, speaking up?
Speaking up helps. It helps a lot, actually, because then when you speak up to an extent, it stops that particular crime from happening, especially from that same source. For example, if, let's say, it's a young girl, and then maybe it's the houseboy or the maid or the uncle or whoever, when you tell your mom about it, then she knows she's not going to leave you alone with him, or she knows she has to get rid of him, or she, you know, because sometimes it starts from, oh, your uncle has come, let him carry you. And then from carrying her, you start, you know, they start, because we've also had cases like that. A young girl will tell us, oh, yeah, this particular uncle, like blood related. Whenever he comes to the house, he carries her, and while he's carrying her, he tries to touch her in funny ways. And she never told her mom. Up to now, she still hasn't told her mom, because she just told us this like some days ago. And so that we can also help, like, come in and talk to the mother about it and say this is what's going on. So in some cases we intervene like that, in, you know, in some cases. So speaking up helps, because at least now you're aware of everything that's going on and you actually know what to do from there.
Wow. So from Miss Nigeria to activist, and your reign is almost over, what's next for you?
I'll just focus on practicing law. And maybe if,
really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, maybe if I decide not to do that anymore, I can do business, whatever. I mean, there's so much to do.
But obviously the Aid Foundation is still
running.
It's okay. Oh, wow. Okay. Thank you so much for having us. It's
been
a pleasure.
Thank you for having me.
We've learned a lot. I think for our viewers, if you're watching this episode and you have been raped, first of all, I'd like to say it's not your fault. You need to understand it is not your fault. You did nothing wrong, or maybe you wore something inappropriate. Even if you happen to do all those things or make any mistakes, nobody has the right to violate you. And you, if you keep quiet, you're protecting the perpetrator. You're protecting someone that needs to be to be put to shame, someone that needs to be prosecuted. Another reason is, if you don't talk, he may do the same thing to someone else. It could be someone close to you, and it could even be something so bad that can lead to death, because if it happens to someone else, they may decide to kill themselves. So it's important that you speak up. There are places that you can go to. You can go to the Aid Foundation, you can go and talk to, or you can reach out to Ezinne directly on any of our social media platforms. You can also reach out to the church as well. We have counselors here who will talk to you and who would help you. If it's a family member, that's the more reason why you need to speak up as well. Don't be afraid. There will be a process, and there's a rehabilitation process, and you would always find love. God loves you, number one, and you know your healing can only come from God. There's a place in the Bible that I'd like to read out for you. It says, But you, God, see the trouble of the afflicted. You consider their grief and take it in hand. The victims commit themselves to you. You are the helper of the fatherless. You, Lord, hear the desire of the afflicted. You encourage them and you listen to their cry, defending the fatherless and the oppressed, so that mere earthly mortals will never again strike terror. God loves you. You're wonderfully and beautifully made. Even if you have been raped, he loves you the same way he loves someone else that hasn't been raped. He loves you perfectly and he wants to bring healing to you. Talk to him. You can also journal. I find that journaling helps a lot. Write how you feel. Pour out yourself in your journal. Speak up. Reach out to people. Find healing.
there's a better tomorrow. You find a lot of people that have been raped. Someone like Joyce Meyer, she was raped. However, look at her today. She's touching lives all over the world. She's writing books, she's changing lives. God has a purpose for you. Even in your affliction, He has a purpose for you. Even the fact that you have been raped, maybe God has allowed you to go through that so that you can help other people. So there's still life. Like Ezinne said about number 8, new beginnings. His mercies are new every morning and He wants to start with you. So please, please, please reach out. If you don't mind, let's say a quick prayer. In Jesus' name, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your child that is watching this episode of The Heart of the Matter. We thank you because we know that she knows that you love her. We ask, Father, that you give her the courage to speak up. Give her the courage to get help. We ask that you also bring healing and restoration, and you also give her a new sense of purpose. Thank you, Father, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for watching this episode of The Heart of the Matter. Until next week, stay blessed.